Well, hello everybody, and welcome once again to Insight Live. And tonight we are discussing how we can turn our disabilities into possibilities. And about 10 minutes into the program, we're going to be interviewing Bart Gee. And I've just had a wonderful time. Well, Melanie, you as well. We've had a great time getting to know him. And he was born with a rare disability, and the doctors told him, okay, that he would never walk, that he would never sit up unassisted, that he certainly couldn't play the piano, which was his passion, but he did it. And then his pastor gave him some prophecies that have not just come true, they are coming true. And I think we prayed, you know, we had a little bit of a prayer meeting before this, and we prayed that God would do wonderful things through our disabilities, through our weaknesses, and this is going to be a very inspiring program.
Right. Melanie. Well, it's a very warm welcome from me, Melanie, and Tuesday night, yes, Insight Live. And I think tonight's program, I was just thinking it's the timing is so good because a lot of us are coming out of lockdown, coming into kind of normal life, but trying to find out what it feels like. And I know personally, I'm grappling with what's normal, how many people should I be seeing, should I even, those kind of things. And then and really looking at our purpose and then getting strength for that purpose, because obviously, you know, we want to be living our lives for the Lord. We want to be fulfilling our purpose. But I think tonight's program is going to really challenge us even on a higher level, where we look at other people who have certain things that actually would limit them in normal settings, but because they've learned to overcome, they have the potential to really encourage us tonight. Yeah. So stay tuned, and you can also share this with your friends as well. This is going to be a very strong Holy Spirit moment, one of those aha moments. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me.
Yeah, I was just thinking of that verse, you know, it says without faith we cannot please God, and I think it's easier to trust God for our strengths, what we're good at, you know, like, look at me, I'm really good at this, so ha ha ha, I trust God. But what about trusting God for your disabilities, for your weaknesses, for when it's not going well for you? And I think if I was God, I would love to show myself off through people's weaknesses and not their strengths, but I'm not God. And this is a live program, so please write in. And if you have maybe a personal story, a testimony about how God has turned a disability or a weakness in you into a possibility, we would love to hear it, and we'll read it out. But we're going to go to a video right now. We're going to meet a woman called Gladys Wilson. And Gladys Wilson, she suffers severe dementia, and basically she was nonverbal for years. Can you imagine just sitting there in an old folks' home without communication, without speaking, just almost like living dead state? And then a woman came along who believed in God and turned her disability into a possibility. So I think this is probably one of the most powerful videos I've ever seen in my life. Be inspired by it.
When people are very old and deteriorated and no one enters their world and they're just sitting there, they will withdraw inward more and more. And their desperate need for connection is all now inside. And if a person is all alone, even if they're very, very deteriorated, there's a longing for this kind of closeness. Mrs. Wilson? Hello. You want me to sit? Can you see me good? Gladys Wilson is a wonderful example of a person who is in the phase of repetitive motion, where people use movements, repetitive movements, because they don't have any more speech or very little speech, but they have human needs that need to be expressed. You're crying. Crying, you have a tear right here in your face. You have a little pain, you want me to touch you. You're very sad. Can you see me? Is it scary? Are you afraid? And if this person sits with their eyes closed, rocking back and forth, and maybe there's a tear coming down, there's a need there. Here. There's a little tear that's coming out. Do you feel it? You feel a little tear? If you gently use touch, and I touched Gladys Wilson for the fingertips right here on the cheek, is where the mother usually touched a child. If you touch an infant there, it looks up, and every cell remembers where it was touched by the mother. And often that person knows, even if they can't say a word at that moment, they won't talk, but or they don't want to talk, but there's a communication. And that person is no longer alone. Can you let me in a little bit? You think? Just a little? You think I could be with you and Jesus for a minute? Jesus loves me. Yes, I know. For the Bible tells me so. I used music, because when speech is gone, music, especially with Gladys Wilson, it was religious music because there's emotion tied to it and safety tied to it. So I used her old church songs. Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. What I did was, when she moved, I moved with her. And when I was singing, because she didn't sing with me, so I matched the intensity of my voice to the intensity of her movement. And pretty soon, for a split second, we became one person. Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. So at one point, when she got very quiet and very peaceful, and my voice became very quiet as hers and very peaceful, and my breathing slowed to her breathing, she pulled me to her, and I moved with her. And for her at that moment, I believe I was a symbol of her mom. Can you open your eyes now? Do you see me? Feel safe and warm? Yes? Can you sing with me? He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 He's got the mothers and the fathers. He's got the mothers and the fathers.
In his hands.
He's got the mothers and the fathers.
In his hands.
He's got the whole world in his hands.
The breakthrough doesn't happen every time. The person will not always open their eyes and look at you. But if you keep trying, and you keep centering yourself and really look at that person and really mirror their movements. Maybe not this time, but the next time you come, you'll have a communication.
You feel safe? You feel safe?
Yeah.
With Jesus?
Yeah.
And me?
Well, guys, I do have tears. You know, we're going to be interviewing Bart Gee in the next couple of minutes, and he wrote a book called Breaking Limits, Turning Disability into Possibility. And Melanie, that was breaking the limits.
Yeah. I mean, my father, I've got two sisters, he had dementia. And just trying to learn the skill of being able to break through, to be able to communicate, And when it's Alzheimer's, it's a whole different thing. But that was an exceptional way of just breaking through to be able to, when she started saying, he's got the whole world, it's just...
And she started singing,
it's so beautiful, so amazing. But that requires a lot of patience, a lot of empathy. I think that kind of, what's it called? Something therapy, I can't remember what it's called, but that is so profoundly, you need a lot of patience and you need a lot of empathy for that.
But, you know, that's kind of metaphorical for me. I think all of us have, well, we have one or more incredible gifts from God himself. But usually, in my experience as a pastor, our greatest gifts, our greatest talents are buried in our greatest fears and insecurities. So sometimes it takes somebody to come alongside of us and just bring that out, because it's very hard to break limits by ourselves. You need a friend. That's a whole nother program.
I think that's why mentors and coaches are so popular right now and have been for the last few years, because it seems like they help us think through some of the limitations. Yeah.
I found in church circles, a lot of times we'll say, well, the Holy Spirit will help me. But the Holy Spirit helps you usually through other people. That's why you have gifts of healing, gifts of encouragement, gifts of prophecy. And oftentimes, God expresses himself through other people. And sometimes we close off to those people.
Right.
That's another program. But I want to introduce you to a lady, a very well-known British cellist, especially in the 70s when I was growing up, the 60s, 70s. My parents were playing her music all the time. And her name is Jacqueline Dupré. So if you're 50 or older, you would, maybe 60 or older, you would probably remember her, because I think she was better than Pablo Casals. I think she was the greatest living cellist in the history of the entire universe.
Isn't there a ballet that they've just been putting out?
Yeah,
it was incredible.
Know.
It's an artistic ballet where the ballerina plays her, and then actually the cello is a person. The cello
is
just amazing. Yeah, I need to.
So we're going to do like two short videos here. You're going to see her at the height of her glory, and then you're going to see her like 20, 30 years later being interviewed, because what happened, you're going to see. Enjoy it.
Jacqueline Dupré stopped playing the cello when she was 28 years old, a victim of multiple sclerosis. She died at the age of 42, after 14 years of unremitting illness. Her story is so unusual, her gift so unexplainable, and the sudden and tragic end to it so beyond understanding, that the world had to invent its own myths, and then, as the years went by, to embellish them. In the process, the stories have projected an image of her character that bears less and less resemblance to the real person, who so caught the public imagination and who meant so much to so many people. Who was the real Jacqueline Dupré?
Jacqueline Dupré was a creature like none other. The problem with talking about Jackie is there is no frame of reference, you see. Both musically, cellistically, as a personality, you can't compare her to anyone.
It didn't fall into any category. Jackie didn't fall into any particular category. It was 10 o'clock on a Thursday, there was a rehearsal. Oh, okay, what am I playing? Oh, I'm playing Dvořák today. Okay, it's Dvořák. If it was Elgar, it'd be Elgar. It didn't matter. It was so well already, it was done. It was done before she even... I think she was done before she was born.
So what interests me about her, you heard these famous conductors, musicians, she was married to Daniel Benedum, et cetera. You know, she was the toast of the town, but she had this extraordinary talent. But what I'm interested in is when you turn disability into possibility, I'm interested in that oomph, that resilience, that kind of call. I like the Apostle Paul when he was in Lystra, he said that God has filled you with joy, okay, and causes it to rain on you. And God can fill people who aren't even believers with inspiration, with joy, just like he did Bezalel when he did interior decorating on the temple of God. He was the first one, the first person to be filled with the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament was an interior decorator. Okay, they don't teach you that in Bible college.
No.
But she was extraordinary. And just now, we're going to see another video of her being interviewed, what it was like rebuilding herself. What touched you about that, Melanie?
Well, I think the fact that she had like almost like a supernatural gift. I mean, we just heard them speaking about it. I mean, even though she lived such a short life, she made such a huge impact, and she just lifted it, basically cello playing and music to a different level.
Yeah. So let's fast forward, 20 years or so, and see what she says in this interview.
How long is it since you've played it?
It must be, I should think it's 10 or 11 years.
And what have you been doing in the intervening years?
I've been teaching. Basically teaching.
What have they been like, those years?
It could be quite difficult because if one's been very busy doing something one's loved very much, it's hard to try and rebuild something that feels worthwhile. So that's really been my job, rebuilding.
And what have you done to try and rebuild?
And since the only thing I've really known anything about has been playing the cello, I've tried to help others.
The press and the communications media have made a lot of your bravery in dealing with what has happened to you. What do you feel about that?
There's thousands of people who have this. And it is a tough thing to come to terms with. But I've had wonderful help from many people, so I think in that way I was lucky.
Have you found it difficult to find enough things to keep you busy? Because you're immensely active, mentally and physically immensely active. Have you had difficulty in finding enough things to do?
Well, my days seem quite full, actually. And I like to make quite sure that they are full. Because I don't want to sit here and mope. But I can't do what I used to do.
Wow, I mean, the emphasis was on rebuilding her life after that tragic disability struck her, and to move on to other possibilities. Mm. What touched you?
Oh, God, I've got nothing to say. It's like a hugely brave. And then she did say she had a lot of support. I think one would tend to feel very sorry for oneself, but she obviously realized she had still had a lot to give. And I think that's one of the things, is this whole thing of having hope and actually having value, knowing that you still have value and that you can actually impart something to another human being. If you can't do anything, you can speak, you can teach somebody English if you're English speaking, or just that there's something that you have, no matter how disabled you are, that can be imparted to somebody else.
Wow.
And I think that's what she managed to do in rebuilding her life.
Yeah. We're going to go to another composer. I'm just on this whole music thing, you know. We'll do the sports thing or something another time, but one of the greatest Spanish composers or composers of all time is surely Joaquin Rodrigo. When they set up the space shuttle and they were in search of kind of alien life, and they had to put some of our the best of the world culture into this like time capsule, they chose this piece that he wrote, which Concierto de Aranjuez, a beautiful Spanish piece. And Joaquin Rodrigo went completely blind when he was 4 years old and had this incredible disability. But God, and I'll use that word, God turned his disability into an incredible possibility, and he certainly broke the limits. And just be inspired by this video. It's wonderful. You'll recognize the theme.
In Rodrigo, by far the most important musical analysis that you can do is not that of a technical musical analysis, but of the spiritual and emotional. At the end of this outbreak, he finds peace, and he will accept God's will, and he gives his baby. Since I heard this story from Rodrigo, I no longer am able to think notes or music. I think feelings. Nothing but uniting my heart to the feelings that this man, whom I love so much, felt at the time that he wrote this piece.
Wow, I mean, here's a composer that just tapped into, I would say, a whole different realm. And the story behind that, you know, if you look at the first movement of that piece, Concierto de Aranjuez, it's like, let's dance, it's all fun. And they're remembering he's remembering his honeymoon and those beautiful gardens that you saw him in. And then what happened is their baby was stillborn.
Stillborn. Died, obviously.
Died, and his wife was almost ready to lose her life as well. And so Rodrigo, he just couldn't emotionally take this. He had that. He just like ran out of the hospital, went back to his apartment, sat down at the piano. Okay, because even though it's written for orchestra and guitar, he composed it on the piano. He sat down at the piano, and he was just praying to God that his wife would live. And when you heard those chords, it's like those minor chords, he was saying, God, please let my wife live, please. And then he gets angry, and you just see this. He's just bashing the guitar. And
well, the piano.
He's going
back,
to the
so
piano,
yeah.
Bam, bam, yeah, bam, yeah. Bam, like that. And then
but
suddenly,
there's one point where suddenly it gets very quiet. And it just, and so that's the point where it symbolizes the spirit of his child going up to heaven.
Well,
is that right?
That's the point where suddenly God speaks to him. And Rodrigo, basically like Job, he said, before I heard about God, but I knew God. I heard God. And then the last note was what we called an artificial harmonic, where you touch the guitar string in a different way. And he said that symbolized the soul of his baby going up to heaven. And man, because of this disability of blindness, he's still blind, you know, don't be fooled that he was wearing glasses there. Yeah. Okay, he couldn't see his wife or anything.
He's on the but, on the boat there in the, but, with that nice river,
yeah,
and he's
but
not,
you could
can't
just
see, it though,
see
yeah.
that his disability turned into an incredible possibility that just amazes and touches the soul of so many people. Mm. I really think that we're going to hear that music in heaven. That's my personal thing, yeah.
And I did a dance to that music when I was at the university. Just absolutely, it's exactly what they were saying. He was saying that it touches your heart.
Yeah. So now we're going to introduce Bart, but we're going to play a little video of his just before we have the interview. But Bart Gee, okay, is a worship leader. Okay, this was not supposed to happen. He was not supposed to be a worship leader, but God had other plans at Hope Church in Malmesbury, England. Okay, that's very close to Bristol. And he studied at the Nexus Academy of Music Ministry in Coventry, England, and is an inspirational speaker. And I'm going to use the word around the world. And God is using him, and I think he's more amazed than any of us, you know, writing a book called Breaking the Limits, you know, turning disability into possibility. And sure, the doctors basically said, you will not walk, you will not sit up unassisted, you're not going to even walk down the aisle of this church, of the church, and let alone play the piano. So let's just see just less than a minute of Bart doing this wonderful song. Music, you know, like the critical inner voice in my head says, Kurt, you can't dance on Christian television, and besides, you're all wired up, what, you know. But it reminds me of where David danced with all his might before the Lord, and there was just something, I like those chords, but I like the hope and the vibrancy of that music. It really spoke to me.
Dun, well, I mean, I looked, dun, at his, dun, I looked at Bart's hands, and I thought, I play the piano, but he's got so much more boldness than me, even with his disability. It's just a miraculous.
But that's the thing. Can God use your disability? Because think about it. If Bart's playing, just the fact that he's playing,
yes, yes,
will inspire people. It's
exactly
not necessarily that he's going to be the greatest technical pianist in the history of the world. But when people see that disability, suddenly they're saying, oh, hold on.
But isn't that
I
the
have
heart?
Some weaknesses.
But isn't that the heart of it? Isn't that what we've been speaking about all night? Is that those gifts that people have stir the heart, stir the spirit.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think I'm ready to say hello to Bart again. Are you, Melanie?
Yes, I'm definitely ready. Are our technicians ready?
Our is technicians Bart there? Ready. Okay, let's get Bart. Hello,
there he
Bart.
Is. Hi, Bart. Welcome to Insight Live. We are so delighted that you could join us, Bart.
Yeah.
And I just love that music that you made. I mean, it's just beautiful.
So,
really, really lovely.
So if we were in your church and you were playing that music, would I have the freedom to get up and like dance?
Yes, yeah, definitely, definitely.
I wouldn't have to worry about people judging me. Doesn't the spirit really comes through music? And I think it was like that with Rodrigo, you know, when you, well, let's start with your story. Let's slow down because I could interview you for like 5 hours and just tell us how you grew up, your challenges, your disability, about the pastor prophesying over you, and just kind of how that's working out in life.
Okay, brilliant. So I was born with a rare disability called arthrogryposis, which means that I have weak muscles and stiff joints. And it affects people in different ways. And for me, it actually affects my whole body. So just to give a bit of an example, I can't lift my arms very high at all. I've got very limited movement in all my joints. Obviously Kurt has said that the doctor said I would never walk, that I may never have the strength to be able to sit up, and I was just basically given no hope to do anything for myself. But I was brought up in a Christian family. I made my own personal decision and invited Jesus into my heart when I was 5 years old. But being brought up in a Christian family, the church that I went to, the pastor, he prophesied to my parents when I was a baby, saying that little by little, I'd be able to do more and more new things that would amaze people. And he prayed for two things specifically. The first thing he prayed was that one day that I would be physically able to walk down the aisle of the church. And this was going against what the doctors were saying. And I remember when I was 3 years old, I used to go to physiotherapy sessions very regularly at the Bristol Children's Hospital. And I remember this one session in particular. I was already able to sit up on my own at this time. And this one session when I was 3 years old, my physiotherapist, she propped me up against the wall and she let go of me. She said, I want to see if you can start walking. And I just couldn't. I tried and I couldn't. And I was really quite frustrated because there were other children up on their feet and running around. And I thought, well, why can't I do that? But then sometime after that, I was around 3.5 years old. And there was one night when Mum was carrying me up the stairs to go to bed. And as we were going up the stairs, I just had this thought in my head that I'm going to start walking now. So I said to Mum, I think I'm going to start walking now. And so in the same way as the physiotherapist put me up against the wall, Mum propped me up against the wall, and she let go of me, and I took my first 3 steps, and then I fell down. And we tried it again, and I took 3 steps, and then I fell down. And then from then onwards, it was a matter of, could I do a little bit more each day? And the day after I took my first steps, it was a matter of could I make it from one side of the room to the other, and I'd get part way across and I'd fall down, and I'd get a bit further and I'd fall down, and I'd get a bit further and I eventually made it to the other side of the room. I was gradually able to do more and more each day until I was able to walk in my own way without thinking about what I was doing, which for me was just great. It meant such freedom, such independence. I didn't have to rely on anyone else to help me move around. And then I went to school, and I would go out with my friends to the school playing fields at break times. And I didn't really want to watch them play sports or take part in activities. I wanted to try and take part in whatever I could. And bearing in mind that my disability is quite rare, I didn't know anyone with the same disability as me growing up. So if I was to take part in these sports and activities, I'd really have to try and find my own way. But I was able to take part in many sports, including running, football, wow, table tennis, swimming, just to mention a few. And jumping to much more recent years, in the last 6 years, because I'm always looking for new challenges, really, I suppose, push the boundaries of my disability. Let's see what I can do. I was already able to swim a mile non-stop at this point. So I heard about the sport relief swimathon. And I thought, let's enter the 2.5 kilometer swim to see if I could do it, which I managed to complete. And so about 3 years ago, I wanted to go the next step further to see if I could do a 5 kilometer swim. And it took lots and lots of training, but I eventually managed to finish it in around 5.5 hours.
Wow.
And then also about 3 years ago, someone got in touch with me because he knew I was into sports and into challenges. And he said to me about this triathlon taking place, the first of its kind in the country, in the UK, for disabled people. It was held at Eton Dorney, the Olympic run venue for the London Olympics. And I've always enjoyed watching triathlons on television, watching the Brownlee brothers compete. And I thought, this is such a great opportunity for me to give it a go. So it was a 750-meter lake swim, a 20-kilometer cycle, and I actually ride a hand cycle when I go outside. And then it's a 5 kilometer run, and I'm only allowed to walk. So I had to walk the distance. And so I've managed to complete this triathlon now the last 3 years. I was going to be doing it again this August, but obviously with all the social distancing measures in place, the event's not happening. So I'll try again next year. And I drive a car which has been specially adapted for me as well. So yeah. So basically, you can see that God has answered this prayer that Pastor prayed, that one day I'd be physically able to walk down the aisle of the church.
But
then the second thing he prayed was that one day I'd be able to play the organ like my dad.
Wow.
And he played the organ at church every week. And being able-bodied, he'd play using both hands and all of his fingers. And you have to bear in mind that when I was a baby, when we had a meeting with the doctors, Mum asked the doctor, with just that little bit of hope, because Dad plays the piano and the organ, and obviously the piano is similar to playing with your hands. Mum asked, is there any chance of me ever playing? And the doctor said, looking at my hands as they are, or as they were at the time, there's absolutely no chance. There was even doubt that I would have the strength to press down a key.
But now let me ask you a question. I want to interrupt you and ask you a question. Okay. I play the guitar. When I first started playing the guitar, I remember my fingers got bloody and so on, and I wanted to pull out my hair. I wanted to smash my guitar. I got so frustrated because I couldn't do what I thought I could do. How did you stick in there and learn to play so well? Did you have your moments of, like, frustration?
Well, I think watching Dad play the piano when I was 5 years old, it just really inspired me, and I thought, I would love to be able to play like that. And I knew at that young age that my fingers don't move in the same way as everyone else, but I knew it's just going to be perseverance, don't give up. And gradually I would see progress as I was playing. I still can't use all my fingers now when I play. I suppose once I could actually start playing, I really wanted to try and get to a standard where I could play in church without my playing being a distraction to people worshipping. And what I mean by that is, because of my limited fingering, I would have the tendency to hit down wrong notes, other notes, as well as the notes I intend to play. So.
So, Bart, just a question. When you are doing your talks and you're inspiring people, what is one of the main things that you feel that people are actually catching from what you're saying?
Well, I go to many different places. I go to regularly to churches, schools, and prisons, and the schools and prisons particularly is really just, I suppose, to sort of motivate them to see the difficulties that people can face, but actually how to overcome the challenges, and I like to try and sort of put that into the way they think. So, for example, in schools, I would actually do workshops where I would get them problem solving. For example, getting up off the floor without bending your legs and without using your hands, and how you would actually work your way around it. And it gives them a problem that they've then got to overcome, and they've got to work their way around it. And then eventually they see how they overcome.
Wow.
How they overcome the problem. And so that's what I like to sort of share when I go into these schools and prisons.
Wow. I love the wording of this prophecy. You know, your publisher sent it to me, Malcolm Downs, who I would love to get onto the program and talk about the Christian publishing world. That's another program there. But I like how it says, the pastor says, little by little, Bart will be able to do more and more new things that will amaze people. So all I can tell you is 20 years from now, you'll look back and you will have done all of these new things. What's a new thing that's amazing you that God is doing in your life right now?
Wow. I think at the moment, the thing that's really amazed me is that I'm actually that God's given me the strength basically to go and share my story all over the place. I mean, a few years ago, for me, actually talking in front of people would have been quite a thing, really, for me to do. I was comfortable sitting behind a piano playing, but as soon as I had to get up and stand in front of people. But God has given me a real sort of confidence now when I share. And for example, last year I had quite an amazing invite, which was to go and share my story out in India. One of the highlights for me on that trip was I got to share my story at a school. It was a Christian school, but they had children there from other backgrounds, and I was allowed to share my story and open it up at the end and ask if anyone wanted to invite Jesus into their hearts. And I could see just in the front 300 children of that 1,200 children there, that 20 children responded. So I really feel now that God is actually using me through my disability, where when I was young, I would pray for God to take away my disability because I knew full well that he's able to do it. But I've still got my disability, but I really believe that God is actually using me through it now, and in, I suppose, more than I could ever have imagined.
Wow, Bart, that is absolutely incredible. We've come to the end of our time as we interview you, but I wanted to make sure that our viewers knew that they could get your book, and it is called Breaking Limits, Turning Disabilities into Possibilities, and I'm sure our viewers would really benefit from hearing more about your story, and especially how you share the gospel and show the hope that Jesus gave you even through that prophecy. So, Bart, we just want to thank you so much for coming on Insight Live with us. This has been so inspirational. We've hardly had any emails because everybody's like glued to their screens.
So the buy the books, okay? It's the www, okay?
breakinglimits.co.uk.
It's on the television screen. And just a step out in faith. Maybe you have a conference coming up or a church and you want to invite Bart, and just go to the website. And thank you so much, Bart. I mean, just incredible. It's inspired me, man, to give my guitar more.
And we just want to bless you, Bart, you know, that God would continue to use you, continue to inspire you as you, I mean, we are all being changed from glory to glory in God's image. So we bless you for just incredible joy, and especially at this time with getting out and breaking all the lockdown situation. Mm-hmm. We pray God's protection over you as well.
And thank you so much. And we will see you later, hopefully in the near future. God bless you.
God bless you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye. Wow. I mean, Melanie, that is so inspirational. I mean, especially prophecy. You know, prophecy is so powerful. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, you know, the Bible says, do not despise prophecy. And I know when I was going into the Pentecostal church and people were like kind of blurbing out prophecies, you know, sometimes they would just say, God loves you. And, well, that's not a real prophecy. Oh, yes, it was, they say. But it's not really that. Despising prophecy is when God says something so incredible over you, like you're going to do this. And then right away, you say, no, not me, like Moses. Nope, I can't speak.
Yeah.
And then you're despising prophecy.
Yeah. Yeah.
And when I understood it in that way, whoa, you can imagine the hurdles that he has overcome.
Yes.
To just turn that disability into
but
possibilities.
But having something spoken over your life, maybe you as a viewer have had something spoken over your life, or and you actually, it's given you hope and it's given you strength. And I think that is really what God loves to do. He loves to surprise us with hope. And if you are feeling hopeless this evening, we are just praying that Bart and some of these other stories here will really encourage you right from the inside of your spirit to stir you into this new season in your life where hope can be birthed even in your weakness, even perhaps if you're stuck at home, even if you've got some physical disability or you are caring for somebody and you just feel that you can't have a normal life, somehow God can break through with hope and with joy.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to introduce you. If you were around in the 60s, you might remember we just called him Fleischer. You know, my parents loved him, and he was a virtuoso, a concert pianist who everybody knew who he was, and also suffered a major disability that almost ended in suicide. So we're going to introduce you to this incredibly inspiring video as well.
He made his Carnegie Hall debut at age 16. And in 1952, he was the first American to win Belgium's prestigious Queen Elizabeth competition. Later that decade and into the early 60s, Fleischer made acclaimed recordings of Beethoven and Brahms concertos with George Sell and the Cleveland Orchestra. But in 1965, over a period of many months, Fleischer began to notice a problem. The fourth and fifth fingers of his right hand were cramping and curling up, and no one could tell him what was wrong or how to fix it.
So literally, they just froze up there and you couldn't uncurl them?
Well, only with enormous effort. But, you know, they have to be ready to work.
So you're sitting at the piano and you feel them like that?
Yeah. That doesn't work. I bet that doesn't work. I don't know any music for eight fingers.
Fleischer is laughing today, but back then, he writes in his book, his career was in jeopardy. His personal life, including a second marriage, was in tatters, and he even considered suicide.
I was in a state of deep funk, deep depression. Yeah. I had all kinds of untoward thoughts. But then I woke up one morning with the help of friends, students, and I suddenly became aware that my connection, my relationship was with music more than with the instrument. If there was a way that I could remain active in music without playing with two hands, well, I had to find it.
And that's what he did, beginning with the surprisingly rich repertoire of music written for just the left hand, including pieces composed by Maurice Ravel and others for their friend Paul Wittgenstein, a pianist who lost his right arm while serving in World War I. Fleischer also devoted himself more to teaching, mostly at the Peabody Institute in Baltimore. Not having the use of one hand, he says, actually made him a better teacher.
It stopped me from a certain kind of teaching, which was the lazy kind of teaching, where you push them off the chair and you say, this is how I think it should go. I had to put all this stuff into words. 4, 5, 6, 1.
And in the 1970s, Fleischer took on a whole new role in his musical life, becoming a conductor. He worked with the Baltimore Symphony and with orchestras around the world.
Wow, I mean, this is, I don't know why we're fixating so much on fingers and so on. And probably the last clip we're going to show, the last video, is Django Reinhardt, whose fingers were burnt. But not many people are emailing in. I think you're so transfixed. I would not be touching the computer screen. I'm transfixed, so I understand that you're transfixed, but we have a few.
Laurel, you wrote in, and you were really, really touched by that first video with the woman with dementia. And you said, this is the dementia video. Oh, my gosh. This is one of the most beautiful things I have ever seen. That's all I can say. Beautiful.
Melanie,
that's
me
Laurel.
Too. I agree with you, Laura. Laurel, I agree with you. Wow. I'm just crying again. I can't. That video is so emotional because I think all of us, we have these deep gifts of God that just need to be coaxed out of us.
That connection with people is so important.
I mean,
so
Rodrigo,
important.
Through his blindness, through his loss, it's like almost like God touched something so deep that he said, you know what? I'm not going to use words. I'm just going to open myself to God, and I'm just going to let God speak through me and just go by my feelings. And God honored that. And he knew God as a Catholic Spaniard. Just like Job coming up into him as he was playing that. It's just so touching.
Well, I just want to talk about just, you know, if you look on social media now, you'd see a lot of people are writing either poetry or songs, music, during this time of this world unrest and pandemic and all these kind of things going on. And it's, I think a lot of people, you know, it's really disturbing their soul, you know, their spirit. And by writing and by just putting it out there and making it, actually, I listened to one song, I thought, that is so beautiful. So beautiful.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I have to get this video in. And this is Django Reinhardt, a guy who lost his fingers in a fire. Enjoy it.
1932. Le swing déferle sur la capitale. Le tout jeune Hot Club de France, créé par Hugues Panassier, Pierre Nourry et très vite rejoint par Charles Delaunay, organise des concerts avec les stars du jazz américain de passage à Paris. Django a du mal à se retenir. La richesse de ses ornementations sonne jazz. À 13 ans, l'enfant prodige commence sa carrière de musicien avec l'accordéoniste Guérino. Il marque de sa rythmique les bals musettes. Il est déjà respecté par ses aînés, qui n'hésitent pas à l'emmener en tournée. Il maîtrise de plus en plus sa technique du banjo-guitare. On se le dispute. Même le chef d'orchestre britannique Jack Hilton veut l'engager. Django est promis à une gloire internationale. Il a 18 ans. Ce soir-là, lorsqu'il rejoint le campement, on allume une bougie, maladresse, tout s'enflamme. Ses frères Manouche le transportent grièvement brûlé à l'hôpital. Un rêve de gloire part en fumée. Django a la main en lambeaux. Cette main gauche prometteuse va mettre 18 mois à cicatriser. 18 mois au bout desquels il ne lui restera que 3 doigts valides. 3 doigts qu'il pose avec détermination sur la guitare que lui apporte son frère Joseph. 3 doigts qui font souffrir son âme et qui donnent naissance au génie. Django rejoue. Son handicap l'oblige à explorer des nouvelles harmonies. Et c'est là qu'il étonne. La brûlure pernicieuse joue ce qu'elle veut.
This really touched me, Melanie, because he was already going. He was in demand. He was, you know, 16, 17, 18, the cream of everybody was fighting, paying him vast amounts of money. But because he lost his finger, he was forced to get creative, and he invented single-handedly an entire genre of music.
And he reinvented himself. He reinvented himself.
And his disability opened up possibilities that no one knew was possible.
So we are coming to the end of Insight Live, and we trust that God has touched you to reinvent yourself, get rid of all these limitations. Thank you for being with us. God bless you.
So So don't fear your disability. Even Jesus could do nothing apart from the Father. So trust God. I know it's hard. Trust God to turn your disability into an incredible possibility. And we will see you next week. And we just love having you, and we wish you wrote in more. But do that next week. And we love you guys, and goodbye.